feel the Word of God in our heart, and then whatever we're believing for, that's what we want to speak. Do I ever want to speak something contrary to what I'm believing for? Only say the things that you want. That's so simple, isn't it? If you don't want it, don't say it. So we're going to continue talking about faith. Amen? How's your faith project? How's it coming? Good. What was the last step you took towards what you were believing for? What do you do? Yeah, you're in the Thanksgiving. Having done all to stand, you know, through faith and patience, Abraham inherited the promise. So faith and patience. Sometimes you need faith to have patience. Amen. We continue to speak the word. Has God asked you to do anything in the midst of this? Anything different? Something that you didn't think of as you went back and asked? You know, it's the steps of faith. And as we've talked about before, sometimes we think that we've done all that we know to do, but in reality, God's saying there's a few more steps that you need to take and before you see the manifestation of it. So just want to encourage you, be encouraged, amen, that it's the steps of faith. And if you'll take time out of the principle, if you'll just take time out of it, I promise you this will go a lot easier. Amen? Just take time out of it. Doesn't matter how long it takes. Amen? Doesn't matter how long, if it's a year, if it's 2 years. We're going to get into some stuff tonight, some things that took 40 years. But you know what? When they got what that God promised them, they weren't diminished one bit. The value of what they believed for didn't diminish because of the amount of time that had passed when they had been promised it or been asked for it. Amen? So take time out of the equation. So we're going to start in the book of Romans tonight. Romans chapter 10, beginning in verse 8, it simply says that faith is in two places. Say two places. What are those two places? Where's faith? What are the two places where faith must be? Heart and mouth. Faith must be in your heart, and faith must be in your mouth. Romans chapter 10, verse 8 out of the Amplified says, "But what does it say? The Word, God's message in Christ, is near you, on your lips and in your heart. That is, the Word, the message, the basis, and the object of faith which we preach." Out of the King James it says, "But what saith it? The Word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. That is, the Word of faith which we preach." That is where we get the phrase, word of faith. Did you even know that was in the Bible? Or did you think that was a made-up phrase that we use when we talk about our church? We're a word of faith church. That's what we're believing. That's where we get that from, that we are a word of faith church. Do we have our confession scriptures? You ready to make your confession? Nobody's ready to make a confession? If I brought you into the police station and put a bright light on you and said, "Are you ready to make your confession?" Would you make your confession? Let's make our confession. Do we have those scriptures? Let's start at the top. Whoever believes that Jesus is the Christ is born of God. I want to hear everybody do it. Let's do that again. Whoever believes that Jesus is Christ is born of God. For whatever is born of God overcomes the world, and this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Who is he who overcomes the world but he who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. But without faith, it's impossible to please him, for he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. So Jesus answered and said unto them, "Have faith in God. For assuredly I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, 'Be removed and be cast into the sea,' and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that those things which he saith will be done, he will have whatever he says. The just shall live by faith, The just shall live by faith. The just shall live by faith. The just shall live by his faith. Amen? Now, as we do those, I'd encourage you, don't just do them while you're here. Do those every day. That's a great set of faith scriptures for your faith library and your faith confession. Faith is in two places. It has to be in your heart, but it also has to be in your mouth. Well, where do we get that concept from? That's exactly how every one of us got saved. Let's jump down a verse to verse 10 in the book of Romans. Romans 10:10. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. So that is the principle of salvation. That is not some theory that we've come up with. That is not some slogan that we try and use in our vernacular. No, it is a scriptural thing that in order for us to be born again, how many of us are born again? I'm so glad we've got 100% participation on that tonight. Amen. Give yourselves a big hand. Amen. In order for you to meet the biblical requirement for salvation, someone preached Jesus to you. And someone gave you that scripture. Because you had to believe in your heart and you had to confess with your mouth. Salvation is the great confession. But who is sitting over your confession? Jesus. To make it happen. So how important is what we say when it comes to faith? It's very important. Amen? We feel the Word of God in our hearts, and then whatever we're believing for, that's what we want to speak. Do I ever want to speak something contrary to what I'm believing for? Only say the things that you want. That's so simple, isn't it? If you don't want it, don't say it. When the news prophesies there's going to be doom and gloom, don't say, well, that's me too. When the commercial comes on and says, if you're over 50, all these things are going to happen to you, don't say, well, me too. If everybody in your family died at 50 of heart disease, don't say, well, I'm almost 50, I'm going to die too. Only confess the things that you want. Amen? God, when he stood up and he spoke in the book of Genesis, do you think he thought about what he was going to say before he said it? I think that's what he was doing for eternity. God was putting in order everything that needed to be here so that before he was ready to speak, he had already had it already formulated, and it was already, you were already in his heart before he said, light in me be. He had already planned out all the days and everything that was going to be needed for each day and all the lives and all the different things that we were going to need. God spent quality time just thinking, and if you'll notice in the book of Genesis, that the Holy Spirit was just hovering above the water waiting to be commanded. And the minute Jesus, God said, light be, or light in me be, everything clicked into place. And do you know that the universe right now is still expanding at the same rate as it did when God said, light in me be? It's still expanding at that same speed. Right now. You can go and go and go. And then you've got to ask yourself this question. Well, if space is expanding, what's on the other side before it gets there? Sorry, that's one of those deep questions about time and God and ethereal, you know, linear time and all those types of things. Let's go to the book of Proverbs. Proverbs chapter 4. Proverbs chapter 4, beginning in verse 20, says, my son, attend to my words, incline thine ear unto my sayings, let them not depart from thy eyes, keep them in the midst of thine heart. For they are life to those who find them, and health to all their flesh. Keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it flow the issues of life. Put away from thee a froward mouth, and perverse lips put far from thee. Let thine eyes look right on, and let thine eyelids look straight before thee. Ponder the path of thy feet, and let all thy ways be established. Active faith comes from an overflow of filling our hearts with the Word. Why is God so intent on us following His Word or listening or studying His commands? Because, you know, the only way that faith is going to get into our hearts is we've got to get faith. We've got to get enough faith in our heart where we begin to have an overflow of it, or just as a tree, when it has too much sap in it, begins to produce fruit because that sap has nowhere else to go. So your heart will begin to produce faith when you fill it with enough of God's Word where there's nowhere else for it to go, where it has to produce. And that's what we're trying to get it to. Amen? That doesn't happen overnight. Amen? Now, all of us are starting somewhere in our faith walk. I've said it many times. Mine was with an inspection sticker. When we were in Africa, they told the people that were coming to the Bible school, if you can learn to believe God for a bar of soap. Every one of us need to start somewhere in using our faith. Faith, one of the scriptures that we just read in Hebrews, without faith, it's impossible to please God. For those who come to Him must believe that He is, and that He is a rewarder of him who what? Diligently. Once again, these, when they start using words like diligence, faith is not for lazy people. You can't be lazy and diligent at the same time. Amen. Have we found that out? Have you just loved the 100-day challenge? I'm so glad that this came at the time that it did, because we needed to be in shape for some things. You know, and I don't think I would have been in shape had we not been fasting something. I don't think we would have been in shape had we not had a faith project. I don't think we would be in shape if we had not prayed in tongues. Amen? So I'm just very, very thankful it helped build my faith. Proverbs 4:23, guard your heart with all diligence, for out of it flow the issues of life. You know, when we're going to believe God for something, we've talked about this before, your faith is the raw material. Amen? So I pray, I go into the Word of God, I find a promise of God, I find what I'm believing for. When I have faith in my heart and I speak my faith, amen? God takes my faith, and whatever it is that I'm believing for, He takes that faith and He conforms it to whatever that image is. Big things might take a little bit longer. But hey, Jesus said you could move mountains. Amen? Size is not indicative to faith. Has nothing to do with it. The place where I store the blueprint of what I'm believing for, though, is my heart. That's where the original copy of what I'm... You are always going to get it in your heart first before you ever see it. It's got to be more real in your heart first before you ever see what's going to manifest. Because you're going to be so completely and totally assured of that thing that you're believing for, it's as if you've already received it because you've already taken ownership of it in your heart. Because your heart is where is the blueprint for your faith. So I don't want to put anything else in my heart that in any way, shape, or form could contaminate my faith. Amen? I mean, there are three ways into a man's heart: his eyes, his ears, and his mouth. I have to be very, very wise about what I allow into my eyes. Amen? I do not want to fill my eyes with heavy violence, deep graphic things, things that I'm not supposed to allow in there, and then also try and have a pure, sincere faith that's going to produce what I'm believing for. Amen? So I want to encourage you, if you're believing God for something, you want to be extra wise about what you're allowing into your heart, because your heart is the most fertile piece of ground on the face of the earth. Whatever goes into your heart, it will grow. You cannot pick and choose. You cannot take seeds in your hand, walk out to a piece of ground, throw it in the dirt, and you pick and choose which seeds are going to grow and which ones are not. Guess what? What's that soil created to do? To grow. And it doesn't care what it is. Whatever you put in the ground, it will try and grow. Why? Because that is the soil's job. It's the exact same thing with your heart. Whatever you put into your heart, it will grow. You cannot control that. I cannot fill my heart with country music and then when the time comes, hope that classical comes out. Trust me, folks, a lot of people live their lives like that. They think I can fill my heart with one thing, but when it's time for the game on, then all of a sudden I can hit play and this different thing's going to come out. And nothing's going to come out unless it's been put in there. And this is why the Word of God, yet again, is the single most important thing to a believer's life, because that is where pure, true faith comes from. It comes from the Word of God into the fertile soil of your heart, and then as you are confessing, it is as it's growing, then you're going to see the manifestation of it. Amen? If you're believing God for a loved one, rule 101 is you need to go ahead and see them already either healed, saved, delivered, or whatever it is that you're believing for. You have to. You have to get an inner image of what you're believing for. If you're believing God for a house, what kind of house? If you're believing God for a car, what kind of car? If you're believing God for a promotion or a job, what kind of job or what kind of promotion? If you're believing God for an airplane, what kind of airplane? What do you want? Well, I'll just take any old thing. Guess what you'll get? Any old thing. Amen? God's a specific God. Now, don't get legalistic and say, Lord, I want a red one with blue stripes, and I want a jingle bell, and don't get caught up in all that. But you know what? God knows the desires of your heart. And what I'm really just trying to say is that it is vital for us to be constantly washing ourselves with the water of the Word of God. It's going to be really, really, really hard for your faith to activate if we're spending as much time with things that, let's say, aren't even necessarily bad, but they're just not positive. I'm so glad that I don't watch the news. Amen. I'm so glad I don't listen to talk radio. I got to be honest with you. From what I know, it's the Russians. That's all I hear. That's all I know. You know, but I don't want to get into all that. I don't want to get caught up in all that bickering and all that kind of the strife and stuff. I sleep good at night. Amen? So what I want to encourage you to do is make the Word of God first place in your life. And whatever it is, whatever avenue that God uses for you to do that, then you need to do it. For me, I like YouTube videos in the morning. I listen to, constantly have a teaching CD in the car. If I'm here, if I'm doing the finances, if I'm doing offerings or busy work or whatever, I have the Word on. I don't really do it when I'm studying because it's hard to hear their voice saying God's voice at the same time. Or I just start copying down what they're saying and I'll just use that verbatim. But I just want to encourage you, if you really want to see your faith explode, put the Word of God first place in your life. First place in your life. Take a set of scriptures, write them down, commit them to your heart, commit them to memory, mutter them over and over and over. You cannot pull something out unless it's been put in. And trust me, whenever we get squeezed, whenever you get under pressure, the most pressure, whatever's in you is what's going to come out. There's no other way to do that, folks. That's like what I just said about listening to country music than hoping classical comes out. We can all fake it a little bit. But when you get really squeezed, whatever's in you is what's going to come out. You are going to respond with whatever's in your heart. I've used this example before, but the pilots on the planes, the big airliners, when those airliners are about to crash and they have what are called the black box, and you listen to some of these men and women on these airplanes as they know they're about to die, and you hear the abject fear and terror and cursing and They're completely out of their minds. They have no control over their thoughts or their emotions, and they're just hemorrhaging all of this emotion because that's what was in them. Now this pressure's hitting them. They're about to die. There's nothing they can do about it, and who they really are is what's coming out. So I just really want to encourage you. I'm not here to tell you what you should listen to. I'm not here to tell you what you should watch. I'm not here to tell you what you should say, but I will say this. Unless you're filling them with holy gospel, Bible type things, godly things, if you're filling your heart with ungodly things, it's going to be really, really hard for your faith to work. Amen? That is a snare. And you know what it's all tagged with is fear and doubt. You know, if you like horror movies, maybe you like horror movies. I don't know. I never like being scared. I just don't like it. I had a real problem when I was young with scary things. I did not like scary movies, all that. omen stuff and exorcist. That was just not for me. That was just not for me. So when it's late at night and it's dark and you hear a sound, it's not the Bible that's coming out of you. It's like you're looking for things under the, you're like, hey, you start sleeping with a light on. Why is that? Because there's no faith in your heart. There's fear. Amen? So, guard your heart with all diligence. And that word, all diligence, it's almost a picture of putting an armed sentry in front of your heart. You want to put an armed guard in front of your heart. And you want to make sure that they have the password to get into your heart. I don't want to fill my heart with vile, ungodly things. You cannot have two things. You can't have hot and cold coming out of the same thing. You're either going to be one way or the other. Amen? 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 5. It says, I am calling up memories of your sincere and unqualified faith, the leaning of your entire personality of God in Christ, and absolute trust and confidence in his power, wisdom, and goodness. A faith that first lived permanently in the heart of your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and now I am fully persuaded dwells in you. What it says in King James Version in verse 5 is when I call to remembrance the unfeigned faith that is within me. Unfeigned means without hypocrisy. It means sincere. It means sincere behavior free from hidden agenda. It means it has no selfish motives. Pure and sincere faith produces whatever it is you're believing for. So when I go and I ask God, you know what I have to constantly do, and I'm finding myself do this more and more. I don't have things happen and then say that it's God's will because they happened. You know what I mean? Like people will make a series of bad choices and then just say, well, it must have been God's will. You know, it was God's will that it must have happened. My bad choices now somehow become God's will because that's how it turned out. But I do say that before I do anything, I should find out and seek what is God's will. Would you agree with that? Right, so I want to stop. I want to stand back and I want to say, God, before I ask you or before I pray for something or before I believe you for this thing, I have a thought in my mind, Lord, but I have to make sure that my motives are pure, and I have to make sure, Lord, that I'm not asking or believing you for something that's going to harm somebody else in the process. So in that situation, I have to say, Lord, I need favor in this situation, and Lord, there's a way that I want this to play out, but Lord, not my will, but Lord, I want your will to be done, because if your will is done, in the ministry, we're always looking for the win-win scenario. We just are. When you have two people in your office and they're mad at each other, what we're always looking for in that scenario is called the win-win. We don't want to lose one for the other. We want to keep both. Does that make sense? This is the win-win scenario. If you will stop, and even with your faith project now, say, God, I am asking for you this. I am believing you for this. But Lord, I am just simply going to say, it's not my will, Lord, but I want your will to be done in this situation, because if it's your will, it's going to be perfect. If it's my will, then it might look like I'm trying to manipulate the situation or try and make something happen. And like we talked about last week, faith is my servant. I'm not the servant to faith. It's not my job to set the table, do all the work, ask faith to sit down at the dinner table, and then I run out and try and make everything happen. That's not faith. Faith is me using faith. Faith is me saying, faith, you're my servant. Go out and do what I ask you to do. Amen? Romans 10:17 simply says, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. The word is the only fuel, say only fuel, to power your faith. Say this, no word, no faith. No word, no faith. You cannot derive faith from worship. You cannot derive faith from prayer. You cannot derive faith from prophecy. You cannot even derive faith from testimonies. Now you can hear a testimony to encourage you, won't it? Like if you're believing for a car and then all of a sudden somebody stands up and says, hey, I believe God for a car and I got it. Is that going to build your faith? That's not going to grow your faith. That's an encouragement, though. That's a good thing. But even testimonies aren't meant to grow your faith. Only the Word of God was created to do that. Romans 2:13. This is really, really good. Say really, really good. Really, really good. It's really good. For it is not merely hearing the law read that makes one righteous before God, but it is the doers of the law who will be held guiltless and acquitted and justified. Let me read that again. For it is not merely hearing the law read that makes one righteous before God, but it is the doers of the law who will be held guiltless and acquitted and justified. This is not just about hearing with your natural ears. It's about the ears of your spirit moving us to act on what we believe. Not just reading the Bible is going to help us. Amen? But it's doing the Bible. Amen? Faith without works is dead. So when I read the Bible, I can read it, I can read it, I can read it. But after spending quality time with the Lord, you should be moved to some sort of an action. Amen? If you're in the Bible and you're reading and all of a sudden you're reading about forgiveness and all of a sudden you start sensing, you know what, there's probably some unforgiveness in my heart. I probably need to forgive. I always know when my love walk, boom, is crashing. I get very sarcastic. I get very mean. I get very grumpy, those types of things. Well, what does that mean? Just like when your body goes into, has a reaction when you don't have enough of the right vitamin, so will your spiritual body go into the same reaction if you don't have enough of the Word in different areas in your life. And we could all use more love. Just by the way you're looking at me right now, I can say that this group, you really need more love right now. You're trying really, really hard right now, and you get credit. But amen. We all could use work of some more love, right? The more revelation I have for the love of God, the greater revelation I'm going to be able to give that love to you. Amen. Thank you, Pastor. Thank you for that. I cannot live in the blessing of the Word, but contrary to what it says. I cannot live in the blessing of the Word, but live a life that's contrary to what it says. That's crazy. Amen? I love the Bible. I read the Bible. I believe the Bible, but I don't do a single thing that it says. What is that called? That's mentally assenting. I mean, that's a whole different ballgame. And you know, there's a lot of people that believe you can live one way on a Sunday morning and a completely different way on a Monday afternoon. That what I do in this building stays in this building. This is Vegas. What happens in Vegas stays in Vegas. I can worship, I can pray, I can run, I can prophesy. And then I can be right back out in the bar the next day. And because, and there's no, you know what we need? What we really, really need? Conviction. The Holy Spirit doesn't convict us. Our own heart should. The Holy Spirit does not convict us. Our own hearts should convict us when we do something wrong, right? Don't you think? I've got Jesus Christ that lives in my heart, but we become so desensitized to the things of the world, those things that used to make me be sensitive about it, I'm not as sensitive about it anymore. You know, I work out with a bunch of 20-somethings, and they're great guys. They are strong. They are fit. They help me. And for the most part, they respect me, not only just because I'm a pastor, but because I'm a Christian. And that's taken a long time. There used to be people who respect you just because you were a Christian. Not so much anymore. But when you put pastor or reverend on it, they will at least attempt to, you know what I'm saying? If they drop a bad word, they'll go, oh, I'm sorry, pastor. I didn't mean to say that. But you know, the more familiar they are with me, the looser their mouths become. Their stories come out about what they did over the weekends and who they were with. Ah, pal, you don't want to hear what I did, you know. And they become so familiar sometimes with me that now I start hearing these words again, and I become desensitized to them again because I hear them. And I'm like, Lord, I spent years. That's just not who I am. I don't like that word. That word bothers me. I know it should bother them. But they're totally desensitized to it. Amen? Can't live in the blessing of the word, but contrary to what it says. Thank you, Lord. James chapter 2, verse 14 says, "What does it profit, my brethren, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Can faith or that kind of faith save him?" What's the answer? No. Read that for yourself, James 2:14. "What does it profit, my brethren, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Can faith or that kind of faith save him?" What is it? No. Faith without works cannot save you. There's no way. This statement shows the difference between real Bible faith and earthly hope. Listen to this. Our works show the genuineness of what we profess. They really do. Our works show the genuineness of what we profess. So here's my question. This is what we'll end with tonight. What are the corresponding actions for what you're believing for right now? Do you have any? Do you have a corresponding action to what you're believing for? I'll give you an example. I'll use what we're believing for. One of our faith projects was Emily going to college. And it was a big faith project for us, and it still is. So we'll give you a little background. So Emily has known since she was in eighth grade, right, that she wanted to go to ORU and what she wanted to do. That is so helpful when your children know how to. We already got that in their hearts. You don't waste a lot of money looking at other places. She knew what she wanted to do. She knew where she wanted to go. So what did she do? We got information about the school. Amen? Don't you think that's wise before you go there? We got information about the school. We visited the school. We met with the advisors. We corresponded. We prayed. We sowed. But most importantly, when it was time, guess what we did? We applied. You know? You might think that's the funniest thing in the world, but you have to have corresponding actions. If you're believing to go or to do something, you should apply to the school, don't you think? Yeah, there's nothing I can do to get her into a school that she's never. I can't just show up. Hey, this happened in Bible school, where people by faith just showed up with a trailer full of stuff and families, but they never enrolled in the school because they were there by faith. They believed that God led them there, that they were supposed to be there. But nobody knew who they were, and nobody had a place for them. Guess what happened? They got sent home. So our corresponding actions to what Emily was believing for was she did all the research she could do, and she applied to the college. Now, let's back up 4 years. Emily had to prove herself faithful in high school even to meet the criteria for going to the school. So she had to make straight A's, mostly straight A's. She excelled in all the classes that she needed to. She sacrificed, she worked, she prayed, she tested high. We did SATs and PSTs and ATTs and DDDs and all the different testing that goes along with it. And she did it over and over and over until we got the scores that she needed. She studied, she sacrificed, she excelled. Michelle and I did a prayer of petition where we went before God because a college education up there is like buying another house. It's the same process as if you're buying another house, same price. So we did a prayer of petition. We, by faith, we went ahead and we enrolled Emily in the school when she got accepted. The lump sum did not manifest of what we were believing for. And that's very, very important. The lump sum of what we were believing for did not materialize. We believe God every month to make the payment for that college experience for her. Now, we had different things happen by faith. Who was here when Brother Jerry was here? What did Brother Jerry do for us last time he was here? Folks, that's faith. That is God answering faith. When Brother Jerry was here last time, he gave a very, very helpful blessing seed into Emily and to her college education. Amen? That's how it works. Don't get caught up in getting one lump sum at a time. I would rather. It's not about getting the lump sum. It's about the process. And so many times we're looking for the quick thing. Get in, get out. And we don't learn nothing. Because we got in and we got out. This has got to be a process, because it's not what you're believing for at the end of the process that's the precious thing. It's all the faith you developed along the way and everything that you learned, because guess what? You're going to use your faith again and again and again. And you're not going to just, faith is not just subject to this world. Faith is your connection to the supernatural. You're going to use your faith in heaven. Amen. It's not just something you're going to use here. We're going to use our faith even there. I would rather get a head start here. Amen. I don't want to be in heaven and have to run off with the kindergartners and go to faith school. I want to get it here. I want to learn about faith here. So right now where we are in our faith project is I get up every morning and I say, Lord, the blessing of the Lord makes one rich and he adds no sorrow to it. And we pray and we believe and God blesses and we're wise. And you know what? Guess what? She's about to finish her first year at ORU. And every month it's been paid for. Every month it's been paid for. We've robbed two banks, but that's okay. No, we did it by faith. No. Amen. So I just want to encourage you. There is a lot of prep work that goes into faith. Amen. You need to do your homework of what you're believing for. If you're going to believe God for a car, believe God for the insurance to go along with it. Amen. If you're believing God for an airplane, have you thought about a hangar? If you're believing God for a child, set up the crib in a room. Get ready. Act. Do something. Do something to line up with what you're believing. If you're believing God for a new job, do really, really well with the one you have now. That's the number one way to promotion, is to do what you're doing now. You've got to, God keeps giving you little things to be faithful with, and we keep letting them go because it's not good enough, and you're missing the point. Stay there and be faithful for just a little bit of time. Quit giving up because it's not what you thought it would be. Grow some backbone. Guess what? Not everybody's always going to like you. I'm very, very sorry, but I'm so glad I went to had a public education. You know why? I can't count and I can't spell. But I had to deal with teachers that didn't like me. They didn't think I was the greatest thing ever. That I had to learn conflict resolution with. I'm so glad I did, because it helped prepare me later in life. I do not have this misconception that everybody loves me. That I was the greatest thing that ever hit the earth. No, I had teachers that challenged me. I had teachers that flat out didn't like me, and for good reason. I was not the best student in the world. But, amen? Amen, let's stand up. I are hooked on phonics now. You watch me now. I don't have to take my shoes off near much to count no more. I got me a calculator. I just encourage you. You know, all of these are on YouTube, everything we've done on faith. And I just want to encourage you. You need to be listening to teaching on faith. Yes. You need to be listening. You need to watch who you listen to for Bible teaching. Because it's whatever level of faith that they're preaching, it is what you're going to receive it. Amen. We need to be listening to people that preach and teach the Word of God from the aspect of faith. Because faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Amen. Father, we thank you for tonight. We thank you for your word. We thank you, Lord, that it will not return void to us. I thank you, Lord, that the word is working mightily in me. That, Lord, it is changing me. It is guiding me. It is remaking those parts of me, Lord, that need to be remade. I thank you, Lord. Say this. I have the mind of Christ. I have the mind of Christ. In Jesus' name. Amen. We love you. We'll see you Sunday morning.